Why is it that there's a gun shop on almost every corner?
Watch me shoot this mother.
What was things like before Boyz N The Hood?
Watch me shoot this mother.
It was Boyz N The Hood.
Yeah.
You know, that was our life.
Turn your punk ass off!
At the time in South Central, it was really tense.
I'm scared now.
Every day, there was something about a shooting in South Central. I mean, it was definitely in the air.
L.A. in the late 80s and in the early 90s was kind of like a police state. You know, you had police cars patrolling all throughout the inner city, as well as helicopters overhead.
Something wrong,
yeah.
There was a very sort of pervasive attitude amongst law enforcement with regard to young black males.
Guys, if they got pulled over by the police, would immediately have to stick their hands out the window before the police would even walk up, just to make sure they didn't get shot.
Driver, put your hands on the steering wheel.
It was the young brothers shooting everybody. We used to call the Channel 5 news on Sunday night at 10 o'clock the murder news, you know, because it was like the wrap up of all the Crip blood activity for the weekend.
Police in Los Angeles obviously had an agenda, and still do, in my opinion, against people of color. And, you know, those who don't agree with that, I don't think they're looking at the same set of circumstances that I live under.
Parts of the city were like an armed camp, and there was enormous tension between the police and the neighborhoods.
Whoa, we didn't ask you that.
It was really kind of a surreal area because here you had these beautiful palm trees and sunny California and these, you know, Spanish-style homes, but yet it was almost like this private war going on between gang members, Bloods and Crips, police, and young black males. That was a catalyst for me to do this film. I'm doing this movie. This is a movie that I was born to make. The catalyst in my life at the time was when I was 12 years old. I was real irate, and just being a young black male, my mother said, well, you're gonna go live with your father. So then, basically, I went up like 2 miles away, up Century Boulevard, off of Vermont and 101st, and moved in with my father.
What's the matter, you can't say hi?
My father flipped the script on me. He was like, you know, you're not gonna be lazy like you was with your mother. You're gonna have to wash clothes. You're gonna have to, you know, you're gonna have to take out the trash. You know, you're gonna have to have chores. You're gonna have to have responsibilities.
I gotta lay down the rules of the house. It's the same thing as weekends, you remember?
Thinking back, that was a catalyst for me to do this film. I applied to get an SC. I got into the filmic writing program there. It was good for me because I learned very quickly that the cheapest way to make a movie was to write a movie. And so while at USC, I got a couple of film awards, and then I finally got representation by CAA and when I was a senior, and things started to happen to me. I was trying to get a job as a reader. You know, I was about to graduate from college. I was like, I gotta get serious, I gotta get me a job. Maybe I can get a job reading scripts. And so I met Stephanie Elaine, and I went to her, appealed to her to get a job.
I had just recently been promoted from being a reader at Columbia Pictures to being a studio executive. So I wanted to replace myself in the reader pool because there weren't that many black readers.
She had heard that I had had this script called Boyz N The Hood.
I thought it was great. I said, you know what, you're not a reader. You don't want to be a reader. You want to write.
So Stephanie got the script from the people that I interned with. It wasn't submitted from my agent.
I sat in my office when I got it, and I read it cover to cover. Closed the cover, was crying and elated at the same time because I felt, this is what I'm here to do.
She went crazy for it, and she went to the top brass.
It wasn't an easy sell. It wasn't.
Most of the folks in the marketing department didn't really have a whole lot of interest in it, but I had a huge amount of interest in it because I'd been a newspaper reporter for the LA Times and I'd covered South Central for a time. And so spoke to a lot of things I knew a little bit about, and I thought it was just brilliant, brilliant writing.
You could tell just from the words on the page that it was a movie that you really hadn't seen before. And it was a world that you hadn't seen before, certainly not in Hollywood movies.
We got around to everybody, and various people said various things, you know, good and bad about the script. And then we got to Frank Price, and he just said, well, I think it's great, and I think we should make it. They're going, wait, what? I said, but John has to direct it, because this was the deal. And he's never directed anything before.
I had only done silent Super 8 movies. I went in there, my first big Hollywood meeting. My father always told me, if you really want to sell somebody on something, you have to act like you really don't need them. So my attitude was like, they said, well, we understand you wrote a real good script, and we're interested in buying it. So what do you think of that? And I said, that's cool. I said, well, you know I'm going to direct it. And they said, yeah, we heard you want to do that. And I said, yeah, well, I'm going to. And they said, oh, well, what if we told you we want to pay you X amount of dollars and have you go on? And I said, well, we have to end this meeting right now because I'm doing this movie. Now, this is a movie that I was born to make. And they said, all right, well, here's $6 million. Go back to your neighborhood and go make this movie.
And I really think Boyz N The Hood was the first time a major studio had ever bankrolled a film like this with so many provocative ideas and such a real inside look at the black community.
That was really a pivotal point because then I was scared.
This is my hood. This is our life.
The studio said, well, you're gonna need a producer. You're gonna need somebody to help you produce this movie. I said, okay, fine.
Steve Nicolaitis was a friend of mine and a well-respected producer, and I sent him the script. He loved it. I put them together, and they seemed to hit it off.
It was like, you know, a religious thing with me. It's finally, I had finally read something that, you know, connected in my soul.
He came over to my mom's house, and I interviewed him.
Here's this little, you know, pencil neck geek. You know, he's just such a little thin guy with these glasses. You know, he's not quite Urkel, but you could tell that there was a fierceness to him, a determination to him.
My question with him was like, how do you feel about working with black people? And he says, well, I don't care if I'm the only, you know, white person on the crew. And I said, you will be.
There were no rules. They were just the rules that we made up to help John do what he wanted to do.
My plan was like I was gonna go to my neighborhood and do it with an all black crew, you know, and that was the way it was gonna be done. Met Jackie Brown, hired Jackie Brown as a casting director.
John and I had a meeting and we just connected, and the next thing you know, I was casting the film.
The only two people that I knew that I wanted in advance were Lawrence Fishburne for Furious, and I wanted Ice Cube to play Doughboy. I had done an internship with the Arsenio Hall show. And Ice Cube was, at the time, was with a group called N.W.A. I'm like, hey man, you know, I'm a filmmaker and I'm gonna do a movie. I'm gonna put it down for L.A. and, you know, I want you to be in it.
I listened to him for a minute, but I brushed him off in a way because, you know, I was rapping. I wasn't thinking about acting, and, you know, why would somebody want to put me in a movie?
So we would see each other here and there every so often. And one time I was stuck at this party that Public Enemy had performed, and I had no ride. I was just stuck in Hollywood.
Same dude run up to me, John. He run up to me and say, remember me?
And Cube had just left NWA, and everybody thought he was so stupid for leaving this superstar group and going off solo on his own. And he gave me a ride back to campus.
Still didn't hear from him for another year. And when I heard from him again, it was a script coming through the mail. Pump my start tripping.
He came in and read initially, and he'll tell you this, he sucked.
It was terrible, you know. And he asked me, he said, did you ever read my script? I said, no, I didn't read it.
And I was like, yo, I really want you to do this movie. Read the script again, go back, and just come back.
So when I read it, you know, I was like, oh my God, this is my hood. This is our life.
And he just came in, and he was like, yeah, you know, I know this role.
Domino, motherfuckers. Say about that.
Yo, MCs.
He was the guy. He was a movie star right then and there. And I was like, yes.
You boys want to see something?
Do we have a choice?
No.
I first met Lawrence Fishburne when I was 19, doing my very first job in the business as a security / PA, you know, on the Pee Wee Herman show.
John was incredibly enthusiastic. I mean, he had this real kind of energy.
John would say, I'm writing a script for you and you're gonna be in it. And Larry would go, yeah, right, okay.
When I read Boyz N The Hood, I cried, you know? After like the last three pages of the film, the last three pages, I was just in tears.
Now Larry's sitting in this room with me and John and Jackie.
My mantra was, I told her, I don't want to see anybody that you've seen in any other movie before.
When Cuba walked in the first time, he knew that Lawrence Fishburne was attached, and he was pretty excited about that.
Hey, Pop, can you fix my fade back here and up here?
I'm eating.
After you eat?
Yeah.
I had worn this shirt. It was yellow with, I believe, black sleeves and a big black circle on it with these Cavaricci pants. He sat down with Fishburne and he did a scene, and it was phenomenal. And John tells the story that when I walked into the room, he saw Trey Styles for the first time. I said, you know, you gotta show up to your first day at work wearing that shirt. You wanna put it in the movie.
Yeah, I get a discount on clothes and shit. You like?
You look like you're selling rocks.
The next guy in the door is Morris Chestnut.
I didn't think it was gonna be a huge movie because, you know, if I'm up for a lead and I hadn't done anything, you know, who's gonna see that movie?
And I turned to John, I say, well, we got Trey and Ricky, you know, should we go have lunch now?
My agent called and was like, this is last minute, but I really think you should go down. It's a, you know, small, low budget film. So I go down and I see a line of girls, all of us looking completely different. And there's this guy, and he walks by, and he stands directly in front of me, and he looks me up and down. He has his glasses on, and I'm like, who is this guy, like, standing right in front of me?
And I plopped down right next to, like, Nia, and I was like, oh, she's kind of cute, you know? And I was like, oh, so who are you reading for? And she's like, oh, I'm reading for Brandy, this role and stuff. And she's like, what are you doing here?
Like, he was playing like he was the errand boy.
And she threw me mad at too. She's like, you know, I ain't trying to talk to you right now. I'm trying to read for this movie, so you need to step. You know, it was just a look that she gave me and everything.
Needless to say, when I walked into the audition room, I almost lost my mind because it was John Singleton. And I'm just thinking to myself, oh my God, I was just sitting there talking to the director and I didn't even know.
Why every time you talk about a female, you gotta say bitch, a hoe, a hoochie?
I met Regina peripherally one time when she was going to SC for accounting.
When I find out, I'm like walking around school like looking for this John Singleton. But he told me he had heard that Regina King went to USC, so he already knew about me. I was just happy to be able to audition for a movie because coming from 227, I did a show for 5 years that was like this daughter that was like any parent's dream child.
She was kind of the girl from the hood.
And I just did three lines and she was like, oh good, no, I'll bring you back for the producer and the director. I just wanted to see if you could be ghetto.
I just wanted her to play like a gangster girl.
I want one of them hoochies over there.
V-Dub, who plays the guy with the pacifier, we were looking for car clubs for the big scene on Crenshaw Boulevard, and V-Dub was sitting in the lobby.
Well, he used to suck on this pacifier because he was trying to quit smoking. And John thought it was such a cool thing, he ultimately used it in the film.
You don't know what I'll be getting. I'll be fucking those dope heads. I might let them suck my dick, but I don't be fucking them.
Tyra Farrell and Angie Bassett came about because I asked Lawrence Fishburne, who are the two actresses that you really want to work with? And he gave me two names. He said, I want to work with Angela Bassett, and I want to work with Tyra Farrell.
He still got that same girlfriend?
Tyra had originally auditioned for Cuba's mom. And when I told her, we're going to switch you because I think you'd really be right for the other mom, she really wasn't happy about it.
Is that it? Boy, don't get smart with me because I'll knock your ass in the middle of next week. And where you going anywhere, you little fat fuck? You ain't got a job.
Really wonderful actress. And incredibly beautiful as well. And I thought it would be an interesting choice for her to play someone who wasn't so beautiful.
Give me the motherfucking gun, Trey.
I think John was really counting on me in a way that I didn't even understand at the time. I had no clue that John was counting on me to sort of be the anchor of his film.
I would go to Fish and we'd sit in my apartment and I said, Fish, you know, what does Francis do with his actors? You know, what's his rehearsal process? And he said, you know, he would tell me, you know, that Francis would sit there and read the script with them, and then they'd take a break and then they'd read it again, and then they would do improvs. They would do all these improvisations that had nothing to do with the movie, but had to do with the characters. I learned all these different things from those lessons and with talking with Fish about communicating with actors, trying to get my vision across without, you know, without acting it out for them, without, you know, to really work on being a guiding force, but in a comfortable manner.
During the rehearsal process, we would start these improvs and we'd start to say something personal, and John would go, what do you mean by that? Well, finish what you're gonna say.
We did a reading with Cuba Gooding Jr. There was a scene between he and Nia Long where Trey comes back after some encounter with the police or someone, he's really upset, and Cuba had gone through this thing and he actually punched a hole in the wall.
And you get so upset before you know it, you're crying and you're swinging. I remember I punched a wall in rehearsal and put a hole in it, and they made me sign the hole.
And I remember saying to John, wow, I really wish I was that connected to my own emotional stuff when I was his age.
You know, somebody might try to smoke me.
I was as convinced as John was that Ice Cube was going to be brilliant as Doughboy. And you could look at Morris Chestnut and tell that he was completely angelic. And as I said, once Cuba got up and punched a hole in the wall, it was very clear to me that he was the guy that could go either way.
I mean, we all were like, all right, here we go. This is our introduction. This is the beginning of our career. This is the one that's gonna set us off.
I can't save you. They're gonna fire you. I remember the first day of production, we shot on the street that I grew up on, Lawrence Street in Inglewood, and it's an area called the Bottoms. And it's like a whole collection of apartments, you know, right across the street from Hollywood Park, in between Hollywood Park and Woolworth Elementary and Morningside High School in Inglewood. And it's a real rough area. The call time was 7 o'clock in the morning, but I was there at 5:30 with the fog up and everything on my street. And I just sat there on the curb and I was just like, getting fired up, ready to go to war. Like, you know, I'm about to do this and my whole life is gonna change from doing this movie. This is everything that I want from being 9 years old and wanting to be a filmmaker.
I went to visit the set of Boyz N The Hood, and I don't think the studio wanted me to come visit.
At first they were really nervous. They were like, you know, wow, you know, this kid's never done anything, you know, how's it gonna come out? They had my agent called, and my agent was like, listen, if the dailies come out bad, I can't save you. They're gonna fire you.
I didn't know what I was doing. I was a creative executive. They promoted me to vice president in order to supervise the movie, because you kind of had to be. So it was like the blind leading the blind.
John was very prepped. He knew exactly what he wanted to do. He knew exactly what his shots were gonna be. He was very focused, and he was in control.
I was scared to death at first.
It was fun. I mean, every time I was on set, I was always laughing.
I'm 22, you know what I mean? Everybody there is like between the ages of 17 and 20, and we turn on the music and everybody's partying. So it's like, it was very hard to get everybody to focus on actually making the movie.
I don't think I could have had a bad experience on that movie. You know, someone could have came up and said, well, you know, you're gonna die next week. Well, I'm doing the movie right now, so I'm okay.
It was fun.
It looked to me like everybody else was having a good time, and I wasn't having a good time.
It seemed like everybody knew they were part of something, because it was the first time that there had been predominantly a black crew.
Now, what we need to do is we need to keep everything in our neighborhood, everything black. Black owned with black money.
The industry doesn't exactly open its arms to minorities, and they're always saying on sets that I've worked on, we couldn't find any black this or any black that.
At that time, you didn't see many black people behind the camera. And on this set, they were everywhere.
I'm gonna do everything like Spike does it. You know, Spike has a black DP, I want a black DP.
I think probably what I did more than anything was not allow him to make mistakes that a brand new filmmaker might traditionally or might normally make.
We shot in the fall and we lose light at 3:30.
There were times when we just didn't get shots that John wanted. We didn't finish scenes that John wanted. And it was just, you know, that's part of the, one part of the movie making process, and two, part of the process of growing up as a director.
Damn your daddy mean. He worse than the boogeyman himself. Gotta do all these things. Who do you think you is, Kunta Kinte?
The most difficult scenes to shoot in Boyz N The Hood were with the kids. They had limited amount of time to work. They were all new. They had varying personalities and everything.
You still collect comic books? Why this fool got more comics than a motherfucker?
His rapport with the kids was one of the reasons why I think the performances were so special. You know, when John's with kids, he can be a kid.
John was really there to help you bring out your character. He could really help you do that and get you comfortable.
When we were in the alley and the gangsters came over and, you know, jacked me for the ball, you know, I really had to, you know, turn on the emotions.
You know, the kids were like fighting amongst themselves, and you know, sometimes they'd get along, sometimes they wouldn't get along.
In the trailer, on a lunch break, we was eating shrimp, and you took my last shrimp. You took my last shrimp, yeah, and you licked it. You got me.
I remember telling myself, you know, I'm never gonna shoot another movie with kids or animals again, because it was so difficult.
You have to think, young brother, about your future.
The first thing I had to do is I had to get over the fact that the movie really wasn't about me. And that was a really important thing for me as an actor. You know, I mean, we have our insecurity and we have our ego and we have all that stuff going on. The movie was called Boyz N The Hood and it wasn't, you know, about Dad in the Hood. So once I got over that, and I mean that they're all brilliant parts, you know, Ricky and Trey and Doughboy are great parts. And unfortunately for me, as a very young man, I didn't get to play those guys.
What's the problem?
You're getting old, Pop.
I'm getting old.
Yeah.
No. I'm getting better, young brother. You getting old.
He was the tour guide, our theatrical liaison to everything we've never experienced in our entire life.
Yeah, he was like the anchor, you know? He was like the big brother. He was the exact father figure that he is in the movie.
It kind of made him a leader in a sense. I don't know if he ever had that before, because before, when he was a child actor, you know, he was a guy who started off working with Marlon Brando and Dennis Hopper.
A lot of times he would make references to Apocalypse Now, because we probably look like scared children to him.
What I think I was able to bring that was important and helpful to the whole process was an understanding of the actor's process in the making of a film and how best to facilitate and create an environment where actors feel the most comfortable.
There was a night when we were on Crenshaw, we were doing this big wide scene with a whole bunch of people. Cube had some of the members of the then Lynch Mob hanging out and everything. And one dude came up on the set, you know, talking about this stuff, whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop-de-whoop. And some of the members of the Lynch Mob, they just rat-packed him, mobbed him up, you know, pushed him out. He was like, I'm coming back, I'm shooting up the whole set. Fuck all y'all, I'm killing all y'all, right? So then Chuck Mills and all the camera crew says, y'all are gonna put a van behind us on Crenshaw while we shoot this scene.
We had threats from local gangs that they were gonna drive by and just shoot the whole thing up. So I had to have the transportation department take all the semis and park them along Crenshaw Boulevard so that we could shoot on the inner strip and not be visible to the cars passing by driving down Crenshaw just to protect the crew.
John told me that colors was dead. There was no more blue and red. So I said, okay, and I didn't really pay attention to the fact that the bad guys drove a red Hyundai and had, you know, red Chicago Bulls hat and jerseys on. And one day, Wolfgang Bodison, who is an actor now, but he was our picture car coordinator on the show, he got a call from this guy named Bone who said, we need to meet. I said, look, I'm a businessman. I don't care about your movie, but you're shooting, you know, 200 yards from the jungle, which is a big blood housing project.
gangsters at the time wanted to be paid. You know, it's like you shoot a movie in our hood, give us some money.
It will take nothing for some 14-year-old kid to earn his stripes to go, you know, drive his car by and try to pop Ice Cube.
We got a problem here? We got a problem, nigga?
So I went back and I talked to John, and John said, nah, fuck them, you know. And I said, no, listen, John, this is serious. And Ice Cube overheard it and said, John, he listened to him, you know, he's right. We have a lot to lose here.
The potential of this guy, this kid may come back and start shooting everybody on the set. And everybody's nervous anyway because of that. You know, and compounded nervousness says it can happen anyway. And then the guy goes back to his car and shoots the Uzi up in the air. I didn't tell anybody that we were gonna shoot the Uzi. I just did the whole thing, and I told them, when you hear something, be ready to drive. It was the first and only take, and that's what's in the movie right now. And so when you see everybody running, you see that real fear.
Directors are good instigators, rabble-rousers, you know, they revel in chaos.
What did I do, Trey? What did I do that was so bad that you just had to stop talking to me?
We didn't get along, and we had to do a love scene together, which was the funniest thing in the world.
That was the most nerve-wracking moment in my career.
And it wasn't that we disliked each other. It was just that every time we saw each other, we reminded each other of the fact that we would have to get naked together and pretend like we liked each other.
He was like one of those boys that had a crush on a girl, and he was just acting silly, showing out, saying the most ridiculous, like anything ridiculous that you could think of that would come out of someone's mouth, he was saying it.
So what I tried to do, which was the wrong thing, was try to make joke of the whole thing. You know, I'd like put my feet on the bed and pick my toes and be like, well, don't worry about it, honey. You know, and she just lost her mind. She's just like, I can't believe he's picking his feet.
And I think it was all out of the nervousness, you know, and just both of us feeling very vulnerable at the time.
When you're on that set doing it and you have makeup people pulling the sheets back and putting makeup on your pimples or whatnot, or fixing your hair or powdering your face, and your breasts are hanging out, I mean, you feel like you're violating this girl, and she's responding that way.
John saying, okay, now Cuba, I just want you to start on her breast and work your hand all the way down. Nia, your face is totally off camera. Don't worry about it. Just lay there and look beautiful. And I'm going, oh my God.
There was one scene that and to this day, it's hard to watch. We had to do a scene where I had just been harassed by the police, and I went over to my girlfriend's house. I go into the room, and she hugs me, and she goes, what's wrong with you? And I say, I'm sick of this shit.
He just lashes out the world and his frustrations and everything, because he feels so powerless.
If you start to peek on something that's interesting emotionally, that tells this story, he won't rest until he gets there. So he kept going take after take, going, no, let it go. And we finally got this take where I'm punching the air and I'm crying and screaming.
I'm so fucking tired of this shit. Fuck this shit. Do me, motherfucker. Fuck you. Fucking dirty as shit. Don't let me kill all you motherfuckers. Come on to me, motherfucker.
The breakdown was so intense that I remember after John said cut, I walked outside and I couldn't stop crying because it was so real.
You could look around and see tears coming down my grips faces, you know. So it was special.
We felt like we caught lightning in a bottle.
The movie premiered at the Cannes Film Festival, and I sat next to John. In front of us was Quincy Jones, Eddie Murphy, Spike Lee. There was like seven or eight of the, you know, the big African-American power players at the time.
The first time I ever been out of the country, never been anywhere out of the United States, was when I went to the Cannes Film Festival for the premiere of Boyz N The Hood. It was a phenomenal experience for me because I didn't really think about this film showing anywhere other than in the neighborhood.
The movie plays, the movie stops. People are literally hanging over the balcony, clapping, trying to get John's attention.
actually having them get the jokes, get the emotion, get the gist of the story. And that was really something for me.
We got a standing ovation from that, you know, after the movie was over. That's when I knew we had something that was bigger than all of us.
Coming back from Cannes, a lot of the critics and writers at the sort of mass media, that's where they first heard about the movie, because everybody really got a big kick from seeing it there.
I'd spent an enormous amount of time beating the hell out of reporters to get them to pay attention to this. First it was, I don't care, I don't want to go. And then they'd start to hear the story of, you know, this 22 or 23 year old young man from South Central who was making the movie, and okay, maybe that's kind of interesting. And then they'd go meet him and they'd fall in love with him, even in his own shy, unusual way. So by the time we got somewhere near to opening day, there was a tremendous amount of respect for him and for the movie in the press.
The test screenings we had were off the hook. They scared us. They were so filled with fervor. I mean, everybody was on their feet during the movie and screaming, and we were looking around ourselves going, oh my God, we felt like we caught lightning in a bottle.
Still trying to get the lump out of my chest.
The film was so powerful that every fiber of my being was touched by different emotions at every time.
It's almost like a documentary. Without looking like a documentary, it's so honest and truthful.
They've given us a view into a world that ordinarily has been historically kept off camera.
Mostly what you saw was conventional big studio, big budget, wide release, you'll pardon me for saying it, white bread movies. So this movie really stood out at the time.
The movie had opened, we got the matinee results, they were fantastic. The projections were coming in, it looked like we were gonna double the cost of the negative the first weekend, and it was just huge.
When Boyz N The Hood came out, I rented a limousine, opening night of my film coming out, and I got all my friends from college, we call ourselves the Black Pack. We all piled in a limousine with some real sexy girls, and we like rolled around the city to every thought of theaters. Like, we went to the Baldwin Theater the first, and there was rowdy people out front. And I was like, y'all calm down, you know, I don't want anything happening, you know, in front of this movie, because what had happened previously in March, Boyz N The Hood opened in July, and in March, New Jack City had opened. And in Westwood, where it had opened, the cops that came out in force. Then we went up to Universal City Walk, and I go in a theater, and there's all these people who are, gangbangers, former gangbangers, are all in the theater, like, yeah, waiting for the movie to start. There was a lot of bloods in the theater. And I walk out of the theater, and these two kids are walking in the theater, and they're like, they gotta be 16 years old. They like blew down. They just crept out and everything. And I told the security guys, I said, please don't let them two cats in the theater. They go walk in the theater. Me and my friends said, let's go. We walked out of the theater. We got to the car. We get in the car. We're going down the hill. And as we're going down the hill, we see all these police cars going up the hill. That's what happened.
I sort of went into shock. I mean, I felt responsible.
Whenever something hits close to home, it's gonna evoke some type of emotion.
And it became apparent by about 1 a.m. that there were, a lot of casualties.
Then when I woke up the next morning, I looked at CNN, they made this big map, and anywhere and everywhere that there was something that happened in and around a theater that was playing Boyz N The Hood, they spot it. Now, things happen every weekend in the inner city, regardless of any movie.
What you do in that circumstance is you stay up all night and try to figure out how to at least, get the word out that your hearts go out to the people who've been injured and their families, and also to correct a lot of the misimpressions.
My film is not a violent film. My film has a couple of violent acts in it. My film is a real film in that fact that the violence that does happen in it seems real because there is so much character development involved.
The studio supported the film. Totally supported it, didn't pull back, and that was important to me because internally there had been some finger pointing.
I think it was simply a reflection of what was going on in our culture, in our city at that time, that there was already an enormous amount of tension and bad feelings, and it would spill out when a lot of people would get together.
The stunning thing is how much the media got wrong, because they're doing it on the fly, they're doing it fast, and this became, you know, the ultra-violent gang movie.
It was one of the first times that it had happened, and so the movie got tagged with being insightful to kids.
Anybody who'd seen the movie knew that absolutely wasn't true. I mean, the slogan of the movie was Increase the Peace. This was a movie that was clearly a morality tale.
John had been really adamant about one thing in the campaign, in the marketing campaign, which he lost, and that is he wanted the words Increase the Peace on the poster. And the marketing team at the time thought it was lame, I think. I hate to say that, but I think they did think that it wasn't good, that it was too preachy, and that, you know, they were going for the ain't no fairy tale, it's all real, it's all real.
All I can say to you guys is try to talk to the people that have actually seen the film, because everybody who has seen my film, no matter what background they're from, black, white, whatever, old or young, they've always end up becoming a spokesman for the film.
There was a lot of love out there, and people were feeling it, seeing it, and writing and calling, and you know, it felt right. It felt like we'd probably done more good than harm.
The film, as it is larger than me. You know, it's larger than anybody who took part in making it, and it speaks for itself.
It opened the eyes to what really was going on in the inner city.
I was in Las Vegas, and I was halfway asleep, and the nominations came on and everything, and I don't remember what came first. I think the one for writing came first, and I was, like, really excited. Then the directing came up, and I was, like, I was floored.
Let's face it, the Academy is largely, I mean, I'm like the youngest guy in the Academy, and I'm almost 40 now. You know, it's like, it's an amazingly older group and almost entirely white.
Boyz N The Hood had such a buzz, and Hollywood is such a, you know, a star-fucking community that people heard about Boyz N The Hood, so when the free tape came, they said, okay, let's see what it's all about, and then you get sucked into it, and you can't deny its power.
I think that it was a real sign that people saw the seriousness of the movie, that they saw it really was speaking to issues that meant a lot to people.
Well, the movie deserved the nominations, you know. I personally, as the producer, think it should have been nominated for Best Picture, but certainly for the script and for John's efforts.
I was very humbled by it, and actually it gave me a little bit more fear, too, especially being the youngest person nominated, you know, for Best Director, and then the first African-American.
I remember one of my first reactions was, I wonder what scene they're going to show on the Oscars. You know, like, are they gonna have to bleep out the language or not? Because I thought, there's not a lot of real Oscar scenes here that you're gonna wanna show on television to 400 million people.
Ricky!
I tried to act really nonchalant about it, but I was like exploding inside with excitement to actually be there and be nominated for two Oscars.
Listen, I want to do something with my life, all right? I want to be somebody.
Boyz N The Hood launched all of our careers. I literally went for myself as a casting director to being like, people would send me scripts and say, do you want to do my movie?
The proudest that I can be in my career in the movie business is that I was the only producer on Boyz N The Hood, and I can't remember a movie in the last 25 years that only had one producer.
What I appreciate the most is him turning me on to writing. You know, he's the first one who told me, man, write scripts. You know, you can write a record, you can write a script.
Boyz N The Hood launched my film career without a doubt.
It opened doors, told an amazing story, allowed black people to tell their stories, whether, you know, whether you're from Baldwin Hills, South Central, the West Side, wherever.
Oh my gosh. Well, let me first say, I got Boys from Heaven, Boys Can't Wait, Two Boys from Sicily, The Hood Comes to Charleston. I mean, I got the stupidest scripts in the world. We got two kids from the hood, right, that they inherit a supermarket, right? And they're gonna do like black peas with machine guns, bread loaves shaped like AK-47s. No!
Boyz N The Hood was comparable to what was going on in hip-hop music in the early 90s, that it was a music that was crossing over to all kinds of other audiences, young white kids, lots of people that no one anticipated were gonna be the market for that. So it really had a striking effect on the people that ran the studios. They of course are businessmen, and they said, we can make money from this.
I think it spawned a generation of filmmakers who were able to succeed to a certain extent in the studio system, because again, that was the most profitable movie of that year. $6 million movie grosses over $60 million. Don't tell me everybody in Hollywood didn't take a notice of that.
I think the legacy of Boyz N The Hood is going to be that even within this industry, that you can come along as a young filmmaker from any walk of life, any background, and write a screenplay and make a career, you know, as a director.
There's no doubt that it's one of the great debut movies of our modern era. I think it also will always have a place in terms of how you can use film as social commentary.
You can tell it's a classic because it still works.
You know, Boyz N The Hood is a movie that will stand the test of time.
It opened the eyes to not just the country, but the world, to what really was going on, you know, in the inner cities.
I think it's one of the most influential cultural films of the last 50 years. I mean, it definitely belongs on a top 10 or top 20 list in that regard, you know, with like a great Vietnam film like Apocalypse Now, and with, you know, a great film like Schindler's List.
As a result of my portrayal in the film of Furious Styles, that I had become, symbolically at least, the father to a generation of fatherless children.
This humble actor is just proud to have been a part of something that I think that will continue to touch people for a long time.
I think when you talk about the history of Hollywood and the history of black filmmaking, there are very few pioneers that sort of open the door and lead the way for other first-timers to come in and tell their stories. And I think John Singleton has definitely been a part of that crusade.
I think writing that film and directing that film was a moment in time for me to reflect on what I've been through in my life, you know, growing up in South Central Los Angeles and seeing the things that I did. And I think that that was a way for me, kind of therapeutic way for me to grow from the experience of growing up in the hood.
Hey, Doe.
What's up?
You still got one brother left, man.
Thanks, man. Later, G.
Later.
All right, Doe.
Watch me shoot this mother.